Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining me for our Sunday school class today. Before we get started, let's open up with a prayer. Quick, short, sweet, to the point, okay? May we all bow our heads. Most gracious and heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for the opportunity to once again open our eyes and enjoy life. With as tough and rough as 2020 has been, Father, we are just thankful that we're still here. Lord, we just ask that you guide this lesson, that we all are able to walk away with something that we will be able to take through the week to spread to our friends, our family, our loved ones, and just to use every day to use day by day. In your name I pray, amen. Okay, so today's lesson is entitled, When Loving is Complicated. Can you any of you guys tell us about love being complicated? I know you guys are still kind of young, and so love may be, you know, that kind of love you might not be thinking about, but think about love between yourself and your siblings, or love between yourself and your parents. Sometimes that gets tough, right? You think about when maybe you get in trouble with your parents and they have to punish you. That love between your parents is a little shaky then. You're upset with them, you're mad with them because you feel like they might have been too tough on you. Or when your brother or your sister breaks your favorite toy or your favorite remote control or something like that. Love gets a little complicated, right? So today's lesson, we're following Joseph again. If you remember, Joseph had 11 brothers, and he was his dad's favorite. And his brothers were not happy about that, so they got together and tried to plot and plan to kill him. Well, they did not go through the plan to kill him, but they did throw him in a pit for a little while, and eventually they sold him into slavery. After that, Joseph actually ended up in jail for a little while, and then he got discovered by the Pharaoh of Egypt. He became the Pharaoh's interpreter of dreams. So before we dive into our lesson and our scriptures for today, let's watch a brief video.
Here you go.
Who's next?
We are, my lord.
You are not Egyptian.
No, sir. My brothers and I have traveled far and came.
Joseph, what's wrong?
Nothing.
Look at you. You're shaking.
It must be the sun. I'll be fine.
Please. Our wives and children are hungry.
I'm sorry, but you haven't contributed to our supply.
We don't ask for charity. We'll pay you with silver.
How many of you are there?
There are 12 of us. 10 of us here. At home we have our father and youngest brother.
Very well. Give them
nothing! 10 foreigners asking for grain. No ties to Egypt. Are you thieves hoping to see where we store our grain? Spies? I don't know what you are, but I don't believe your story.
Your Excellency, everything we say is true. I swear it.
Then prove it. Produce this youngest brother.
But why?
What would that prove? That
you're not lying. If you're telling the truth, I'll let you buy all the grain you want. Until then, arrest this one. We'll hold him until you produce this youngest brother. Take him.
Stop! Judah! Look. Help me!
No!
No! Let's go!
No!
Joseph, what are you doing? They're just trying to feed their families.
They're thieves. Here to steal our grain.
They needed food, and they were prepared to pay for it. How can you say they're thieves? They've done nothing to you.
Nothing. They're my brothers.
What?
They sold me. They sold me into slavery. They took me away from my home. I never got to say goodbye to my mother. I never got to see my father grow old.
Joseph, I didn't know. You're here now. You have a home, a wife who loves you, everything you could want.
No, not everything.
I thought thought you learned something in that cell. Remember when I would bring food to you?
Yes. It kept me going.
Hey, you won't keep me here. My brothers will come for me.
My brothers will come.
My brothers will come.
My brothers will come. My brothers will come.
Joseph. How long must there be anger here before we can rejoice? Embracing love instead of fear is but a simple choice. It's hard for me to see you fall, so bitter and so blind, when the truest nature of us all invites us to be kind. Bloom, may you know the wisdom only time breeds. There's room.
The family of Canaanites, they've returned.
Thank you.
Maybe they've suffered these last 20 years as well. Maybe they've changed.
No, I don't think so.
Don't speak unless you're spoken to.
Welcome. You've done what I've asked?
Our brother, Benjamin.
Okay, so now that that video is over, it kind of sets the groundwork for our lesson today. We're going to start out by reading the scriptures. It's quite a few, so just keep up with me if you can. We're going to start with Genesis, the 42nd chapter, and we're going to read verses 6 through 25. Now Joseph was the governor of the land, the person who sold grain to all of its people. So when Joseph's brothers arrived, they bowed down to him with their faces to the ground. As soon as Joseph saw his brothers, he recognized them, but he pretended to be a stranger and spoke harshly to them. "Where do you come from?" he asked. "From the land of Canaan," they replied, "to buy food." Although Joseph recognized his brothers, they did not recognize him. Then he remembered his dreams about them, and he said to them, "You are spies. You have come to see where our land is unprotected." "No, my lord," they answered. "Your servants have come to buy food. We are all the sons of one man. Your servants are honest men, not spies." "No," he said to them. "You have come to see where our land is unprotected." "But," they replied, "your servants are 12 brothers, the sons of one man who lives in the land of Canaan. The youngest is now with our father, and one is no more." Joseph said to them, "It is just as I told you. You are spies, and this is how you will be tested. As surely as Pharaoh lives, you will not leave this place until your youngest brother comes here. Send one of your number to get your brother. The rest of you will be kept in prison, so that your words may be tested to see if you are telling the truth. If you are not, then as surely as Pharaoh lives, you are spies." And he put them all in custody for 3 days. On the third day, Joseph said to them, "Do this, and you will live, for I fear God. If you are honest men, let one of your brothers stay here in prison while the rest of you go and take grain back to your starving households. But you must bring your youngest brother to me so that your words may be verified and that you may not die." This they proceeded to do. They said to one another, "Surely we are being punished because of our brother. We saw how distressed he was when he pleaded with us for his life, but we wouldn't listen. That's why this distress has come upon us." Reuben replied, "Didn't I tell you not to sin against the boy? But you wouldn't listen. Now we must give an accounting for his blood." They did not realize that Joseph could understand them since he was using an interpreter. He turned away from them and began to weep, but then came back and spoke to them again. He had Simeon take from them and bound before their eyes. Joseph gave orders to fill their bags with grain, to put each man's silver back in his sack, and to give them provisions for their journey. So our key verse for this lesson comes from Genesis 42nd chapter, and it's verse 22. It states, again, Reuben replied, "Didn't I tell you not to sin against the boy? But you wouldn't listen. Now we must give an accounting for his blood." Reuben is one of Joseph's brothers, and he's referring to way back when Joseph was still a boy and they were plotting to kill him. Reuben was actually the only brother who took up for him and did not want them to kill him or do anything bad to him. And now he's really feeling bad about still going along with the plan of selling the brother into slavery. So let's look at work out. It just dives a little bit deeper into the lesson and gives us a better understanding of exactly what's going on. So in today's lesson, Joseph's interpretation of Pharaoh's dream had become reality. If you remember, he talked about there being a famine that was going to come to Egypt and all of the surrounding lands, and that's exactly what happened. So it also reached Canaan, which is where Joseph and his family are from. So his brothers ended up finding out that there was grain for them to come and buy, and so they made the trip from Canaan to Egypt. When they arrived in Egypt, Joseph recognized his brothers, but they didn't realize who he was. So Joseph kind of took advantage of this situation, and he wanted to use his power and authority, and really he could have had them killed if he wanted to. However, instead of giving in to anger and bitterness and still being upset about the situation, he was moved to help his brothers, but he couldn't resist the opportunity to still test them, teach them a little bit of a lesson, and see if they had actually grown up and become mature men instead of being the bitter and jealous boys that they once were. You see, Joseph's childhood dreams came true. His brothers actually did have to bow down before him. At first, he refused to reveal his identity to his brothers, and he distanced himself by addressing them with an interpreter, knowing full and well that he actually could understand them. They just didn't know that. Joseph held his brothers for 3 days, deliberately accusing them of being spies, but he promised to let them go if they would bring their youngest brother Benjamin back to him. His plan was to reunite and protect his family, but Reuben was the one who assumed that they were actually being punished for their previous actions against Joseph. Still hiding his true identity, he gave his brothers the grain that they came for, and then he also ordered his servant to put their money back into the bags of grain, but not telling them that he, you know, gave the money back and did not make them pay for it. So Joseph had an opportunity to be mean, to be hateful and spiteful against his brothers for everything that they did to him. However, he used this opportunity to forgive and move on. Next, let's move to Inside Out. Joseph was given a very special opportunity to prepare his relationship with his brothers. This teaches us a very important lesson of how we should act when someone mistreats us. Even though people treat us wrong, you can trust God to bring you through it. If you remain faithful and trust Him to handle it, God will position you to overcome even the most difficult situations. Instead of seeking revenge, Joseph was ready to let go of his brother's great sin against him and bless the very people who caused him such harm. You should be willing to forgive others just as freely as God has forgiven your sins and shortcomings. That's a very powerful statement, because a lot of times human nature in us wants to, you know, get people back. You know, he did me wrong, so I'm going to turn around and do wrong to him. But if we follow Joseph's lead, he used this opportunity to not only teach his brothers a lesson a little bit, which was, you know, a little funny, but he also used it to show them that even though they didn't know who he was, he used it to show them that he actually did forgive them, although they did something really terrible to him, selling him into slavery and then also him ending up in jail for many years. Would you be capable of doing that if your siblings did that to you? Would you be willing to forgive them even though they did something wrong to you? Think about it. You know, I have two sisters, and, you know, growing up, we used to do all kinds of silly stuff to each other, you know, little things to each other to make each other mad, and we would hold grudges about it for a long time. Imagine if your sibling sold you into slavery and you ended up having to be in jail because of it. How would you feel about that? I wouldn't be too happy, and I honestly don't know if I'd be as forgiving as Joseph was of his brothers. that's something to think about. So if we move on, let's look at, there's an app for that. So after the text in this section, let's kind of really think about all of this. One lesson that we can truly learn from Joseph and his brothers is that broken relationships do not have to remain broken if we don't want them to. Realize that no one can take back or undo hurtful things that they have done to us. However, with God's help, it's possible for us to let go of deep hurts, even though it's not easy. When you have been deeply hurt, revenge and bitterness are not the only options that you have. Through his tears, Joseph teaches that anyone can make the intentional choice to forgive, even though the pain is still very real. With God's help, even the most difficult relationships can change for the better. I know, you know, you guys have probably friends that you guys have gotten into arguments about things, and you may have said hurtful things to each other to the point where you feel like, I could never be her friend, or I could never be his friend for saying something so mean to me. But this tells us that with time, with prayer, talking to God, and helping him to work us through that situation, he can heal even the most broken relationships, as proven with Joseph and his brothers. Again, he had the choice. He could have been very hateful and spiteful against them, but instead, he used this opportunity to not only mend his relationship with his family, but to protect them by sending them food that they needed because the land that they lived in was famished. They had no water, they had no food, they had nothing. And he could have sent them home with nothing, but being a good person and letting God lead him, he did the right thing and repaired his relationship with his family and sent them home with all the nutrients that they needed. So let's look at walk out. Joseph concealed his true identity from his brothers until the appropriate time. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 reminds us that sometimes it's best to be quiet and tell God about your hurts and disappointments in prayer. It's easy for us to run to our friends and run to other people and talk to them about our problems and situations in life, but the best and the greatest friend that you have is God. And when we go to him and talk to him in quiet, he will reveal to you exactly what you need to know to help solve that problem. When the time is right, God will give you the courage and the grace to express your feelings in a way that heals broken relationships rather than making things worse. A lot of times when we depend on ourselves and we depend on our own thinking, we make things a whole lot worse than they even started out being. But when we go to God, he will turn things around and make things better than they were before. Let's look at stepping out. There are a few questions I want to ask you guys that I'm going to challenge you to think about. Of course, we're not in the classroom together, so you can't answer me right here. But I want you to think about them. Give it a lot of thought. If you have to think about it throughout the week, to come up with a really good answer about these. And please feel free on the chat below to answer the questions if you would like. Question number one. Do you think everyone deserves forgiveness for their wrongdoings? That's a tough question. What do you think? Number two, when someone has hurt someone intentionally, should that person be forgiven for his or her actions? So we're not talking about somebody doing something on accident or unintentionally. We're talking about someone who knows exactly what they were doing when they hurt you. They had every intention to hurt you. Does that person deserve forgiveness? Number three, does God expect us to forgive people who haven't apologized? Now that's a deep one. Sometimes we never get the apology that we feel that we deserve. Does that mean that we still have to withhold forgiveness for that person? A lot of times, forgiveness is not for the other person, but for you to be able to move on, for you to be able to let that person, you know, hey, you hurt me, I forgive you. Let's move on. Even if they choose to stay stuck in the past and still be upset about it, at least you have freed yourself of bitterness and guilt and anger and hurt and all those bad emotions we feel when somebody hurts us. So we have a few other questions in our book under It's Game Time. I've got six questions for you where I kind of started off and you're going to finish the end of the question. Number one, when a friend or a family member mistreats me, I feel, how do you feel? How does that make you feel when someone mistreats you, especially someone close to you? Number two, when I mistreat others, I should do what? Should you pretend like it didn't happen? Should you apologize? Should you first consult with God about how you should handle the situation and move forward? Those are some things to think about. Number three, God will fight my battles. This means what? That can mean a whole lot of things depending on how you interpret that statement. Number four, God expects me to show love even when my brother breaks my remote control to my Xbox, when my sister eats the last of whatever was in the fridge that I really wanted to eat. God expects me to show love even when my parents punish me for doing something wrong and I feel like the punishment was too harsh. Some things to think about, you guys. Number five, God forgives me when I ask for forgiveness. Therefore, what? God forgives us for doing a lot of things wrong that people know and some things that people don't know about. So God extends grace, mercy, and forgiveness to us daily. So shouldn't we give that same grace, mercy, and forgiveness to those who have done wrong to us? Surely if God can forgive us, we can forgive others, right? Number six, I need to pray and talk to God daily. So I write in my prayer journal or go to my prayer closet or sit and meditate on his word daily. There are so many different ways that we can communicate with God. It doesn't just have to be down on your knees saying a prayer to him every single day. It could be, you know, I know things are very different for us right now with you guys going to, some of you are going to school face-to-face, some of you doing school virtually, but even just in the middle of everything that's going on, just having a real conversation with him, you know, giving him thanks and gratitude for things that he does for us daily, and also talking to him about the things that we need. We shouldn't just go to God every single time we need something. He just wants to hear from us, just like you call up a friend or text a friend every day. He should be the same way. We should have the same relationship or even a better relationship with him than we do with our friends. So in the end, just know that forgiveness can be hard, especially when people do things that are very, very hurtful to us. However, because God forgives us, we should extend that same forgiveness to those who have done wrong to us. I know this was a lot. I know it was a lot for us to grasp and think about, but just know throughout the week, think about this lesson, think about some of the questions that we talked about, and I'd like to hear what you think. In closing, I'm going to leave you guys with a song. It is called I Need You to Survive by Hezekiah Walker. Just think about the words to this song, meditate on the words to this song. Talk to God while you meditate on the words to this song. And just remember, God loves you and I do too. Have a great week.
Somebody tell them, I need you.
I need you.
You need me.
You need me.
We're all apart.
We're all apart of God's body.
Stand with me.
Stand with
me. Look at somebody, tell them, agree with me.
Agree with
me. We're all apart.
We're all apart.
your mouth and say, I need you.
I need you.
Let me hear you. You need me.
You need me.
For we're all.
We're all a part of God's body.
Stand with me.
Stand with me.
Agree with me.
Agree.
Survive.
I need you to survive.